Senate Deputy Majority Leader John DeFrancisco, your voice in the New York State Senate is here to set up the 2017 session, what it looks like 1 week in. Thanks for joining us. I'm Julia Locandy. Hi, Senator DeFrancisco.
Hello. We're at it again.
Yes. So last week was the first week of session, and that's usually followed traditionally by the State of the State message, but this is the third year in a row that that is not happening.
Yeah, it's a shame. You know, at the beginning of a legislative session in the federal government, there's a message of the state of the country, state of the nation, and that's done before the legislative body, the Senate and the House of Representatives. And, you know, it's traditional. Basically, you're telling the legislature who you have to work with, or you should work with, in order to get an agenda passed, what your priorities are and what the state of the state is in case of the state government. And, you know, 2 years ago, he kind of combined the state of the state with the budget because of his father's death, and you can understand that. But thereafter, he kept it out of the assembly chambers where it has been forever, and he took it off the first day of scheduled session and did it when he wanted to. And, you know, probably we should have said something then. But now it's even gone one step further. Not only are we not going to be in the assembly chambers like we traditionally are, and not only isn't he going to address us at all, he's taking a tour around the state. And I just think that's, number one, totally disrespectful. If he wants to campaign for his next term as a governor, he can certainly do that. But I think the legislature deserves the courtesy of what tradition has been. Tell us what the state of the state is, and tell us what you want to do face to face. And didn't happen.
So today he was in New York City and Buffalo. Do you want to talk about some of the things that he wants for this year?
Well, the most significant thing that he led off with, even started talking about it last week, was free tuition for college students in state schools. You know, this concept of free stuff is getting to the point where people got to recognize that free isn't free. Somebody's got to pay for it. Mm-hmm. And of course, none of the details were given in his state of the state messages that he started already or in his press release. And that's one of the things we got to look at very closely. Everybody would like to be generous and help people. But on the other hand, when you're burdening other people with more tax requirements, you're basically hurting the economy in the state of New York. In the past, we have had situations for years where we lose congressional seats because we lose population in relation to other states. Other states gain more population than we do, so they're entitled to more representatives in Congress. We lost two the last census, and we lost two the census before that, and the census before that. So that's one thing, but now, this year for the first year, we lost people on a net basis, not in relation to other states. We actually are going down in population. Now, and that includes the fact that we are gaining immigrants that are coming into New York City and swelling the numbers in some cities like Syracuse from immigration. We're losing people. That means that something's wrong. And one of the main things that I believe is wrong is the tax structure, which encourages people to go for greener pastures and be able to make a living in another location. And so you can get a big headline. You can make a lot of people that think they're going to save some money by not having to pay for college. But in the long run, those revenues are going down, down, down. And you're not going to be able to sustain even the help we were giving students in the past.
Right. You brought up immigrants. And at the end of the year, the governor vetoed your bill that would provide legal services for the poor. In the New York City speech today, he talked about doing that for immigrants. What do you think about that?
Well, we passed a bill to provide indigent legal defense costs to be paid by the state, not the counties. And that bill was based on a settlement of five lawsuits. Five counties brought suits against the state of New York saying the Constitution requires you to provide assistance to counsel, not the counties. It requires the state to do that. and we think this is not being provided adequately by the counties. So those five suits were settled by negotiation with the attorney generals, the people who brought the lawsuit, and the governor's office. And so all the bill was to do is to extend from those five lawsuits that agreement so it applies to every county throughout the state, which will help pay for some of these costs rather than going on the county tax rolls and using property tax for that and the like. Well, he vetoed that. Now, he says it costs too much. And my argument there, number one, he negotiated for the five counties. It must have been somewhat apparent to somebody that it's the other counties are going to want it the same benefit.
Right.
And the other defendants are going to want the same benefits. And so he said, we couldn't afford it. We'll talk about it during the budget. Now, to give in a state of the state message right on the heels of vetoing this benefit for the counties and defendants and all the other counties other than the five, a benefit to immigrants, and I assume he not only means legal immigrants, which they would be covered anyway, but also, to be politically correct, undocumented residents of the state of New York, illegal immigrants in plain language, it just is amazing to me. It's just totally amazing to me. And what it does by not extending it to the other counties, the settlement, if I'm a county attorney or a county executive in each of the other counties, I'd bring a lawsuit. And my lawsuit would be, you've already agreed that it's the state's responsibility. You already agreed to the payment methodology. Right. And that means, 57 other lawsuits to get to every county in the state. And what are you going to do when those lawsuits and the cost to government to defend those lawsuits, you're going to end up with the same settlement. You can't do anything differently. You've already locked yourself in. Or if they don't settle, if there's already a settlement, isn't a court going to order the same thing? So by our bill, I thought we were saving time and court effort and just making a direct application. So it's really a shame. There's got to be some logic in the process, and I don't get that part, logic in that part of the discussion.
Right. He also talked about criminal justice reforms, like raise the age, something we've talked about on this program. I wonder if you're going to push for your prosecutorial conduct commission again.
Definitely. First of all, raise the age. He brought that up a couple years ago, and I was chair of finance, and it was almost embarrassing. It was actually comical. My questions to the acting commissioner in that area, he had no clue what the bill said, what it meant. If you're going to change where a youth is prosecuted, where are they going to be arraigned? Who gets control over whether the case is transferred to this family court? None of the answers were given. So we went silent for 2 years. And I hope, maybe a good proposal, but on the other hand, better be explainable because we're going to have the same questions. And if it's a good proposal, we'll deal with it. As far as the prosecutorial conduct bill, that should have happened a long time ago. And it basically is the same as the Commission on Judicial Conduct. We've had that since the 70s. An avenue of someone who has a complaint about a prosecutor can go to an independent body to review it. It probably will be exonerated, or the prosecutor, in most cases, are exonerated if it follows the pattern of judges. People complain a lot about everything. But there's at least an avenue for people to get justice done if there is an injustice. And so I'm going to keep going. Neither House has passed it yet. I thought it was close last year, and it didn't happen. I just think it's a common sense approach, and that's going to be one of the things I hope we bring to the table from the state Senate.
Right. In Buffalo, he said that ride sharing is not in upstate anymore because it needs the legislators' approval. Is that going to happen?
Well, that's true. That's why you ought to be able to talk to the legislature in the same city, in the same room. Because if that's a problem, this was one of the things in the discussions that were done prior to session. That special session that was rumored. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't agree with my wife all the time. We've been married 48 years. There's nuances to every bill. The fact that you throw this bill out, that doesn't mean it makes sense or it's a good bill. It could be changed. There's no fingerprinting in the bill. And I think that's important. If you want to drive what is like a cab and you want to pick people up and drive them places, shouldn't people have the protection that they're getting in someone's personal car to know that this person hasn't been charged with a rape or convicted of a rape or a sexual offense or something that puts that passenger in danger? Mm-hmm. Now, that I think is important. In addition, the governor's proposal is like at least a 4% tax on the costs of these rides. And what he wanted to do in off session was 3% of it goes to the state treasury, 1% to be determined later. Now, I've been in enough situations with the governor's office to be determined later means that we'll have to pay for it again with some other thing he wants before we get it. I believe that the extra 1%, if there's going to be a tax at all, should go to upstate mass transit. And mass transit includes in upstate the Central New York Regional Transportation Authority, Centro. Rochester is the same. Albany's got the same. Long Island's got the same. They're struggling trying to provide transportation for people in a mass transit way. And to say, well, we're not going to discuss that yet. We'll talk to you later about it. You know, I don't think that's right. I don't think we should go for it until people are protected. And if there's going to be revenue generated, everybody knows where the revenue's going.
And for regional economic development councils, he's going to continue that again this year.
Yeah, and we would have to, it's not that the council is a bad thing. It's good to have regions get together and see what their priorities are. Mm-hmm. But the problem is there's one person who makes the decisions on who gets multi-million dollar contracts for economic development. To me, that's wrong. And we've already seen there's some problems with that process, to put it mildly. In Central New York, we saw a situation where $90 million was taken on a regional economic development pot to be used for a economic development project, and it wasn't even discussed by the Regional Economic Development Council. It was mandated by the governor, so we're going to use some of this money for. Now, why go through the regional economic development process? And I know he's saying at some of the regional state of the states that we don't like them because we like the pork, we want to spend the money. Well, let me just put it this way. If he's not looking for checks and balances for the legislative branch to make sure these projects are legitimate, that they're good projects, it's a good good basis for spending taxpayers' money, why would he be against it other than he makes all the decisions? He's got all the pork. And, you know, to turn it around and say it's us is just wrong. And this blame game is getting sickening. It's getting sickening. If he wants some of the things he's looking to do, compromise. If he wants some of the things he's looking to do, work with us if there's language changes that would satisfy the legislature. We're not all dummies, and he doesn't have access to all the knowledge in the world. And it's important that we compromise on some of these things and work together and have a functional state government. And to be functional, you got to work together.
It seems like he wants to do a few more of these competition-type things for health hazards. He mentioned local communities coming up with ways to fix the bad water situations.
And after the competition is underway, who picks the winners? Let me guess. I haven't seen the bill yet. It's just a press release now.
And what about the health department? Why don't they come up with these decisions?
Well, they do, but they're directed by the governor. He'll pick whatever organization he feels is most importantly. Of course, it should be the health department, but there's got to be some input. There's going to be a competition so that legislators could represent their districts and help advocate for and hopefully get the best type of projects.
Early voting, what do you think about that?
You know, with citizenship, there's some type of responsibility, all right? There's a day for voting. And if it's too inconvenient for you to take some time out to vote when the polls are open 6 in the morning to 9 at night, I'm not so sure we should be trying to accommodate people that simply cannot do that. When we have absentee voting, if you're out of this jurisdiction, you can vote by absentee. That's already provided for you. You get a ballot ahead of time. But to allow everybody to vote early, it causes a lot of problems. Number one, what's to say that if you vote early, you're not going to also vote often? That you could come back to another jurisdiction, another place in the state of New York, and say that you want to vote. And especially with same-day registration, if you want to defraud the system, you can go to another borough in New York City after you've voted in Manhattan and say, I want to register to vote today, and I'm going to register. And you vote there, and then you vote another place. Secondly, I think this is just as important, maybe more important. Campaigns go over a period of time. If you vote on October 15th, even in this election, a lot's happened between October 15th and November election day, November 8th. You've got time. You're not hearing the entire campaign. And then some states who have early voting actually have a process for retracting your vote and voting again based upon changed circumstances.
Right.
Now, all that could be clearly corrected by voting on election day. And if you can't vote on election day because you're ill or you're out of town, we already have absentee voting that you could get your ballot ahead of time and vote. But that ballot should be sent out in time to get it back for election day, not this long period of time where you can vote and vote early and often. And people that say that doesn't happen, I don't agree at all.
So there are a lot of issues that we're going to be talking about over the weeks and through the budget. Is there anything that you would like to end this program with?
Well, I just think the main thing that we should be doing in the state of New York right now, when tax revenues from the personal income tax are going down, when people are leaving the state, we're losing people, not in relation to other states, not only that, but on the raw number, we're losing people. There's a reason, and we got to correct that reason. Basically, instead of giving out hundreds of millions of dollars to various organizations hoping they're going to come here and do what they got to do to gain jobs, reduce the tax levy, reduce some of the energy costs across the board so everybody's working under the same rules and you are benefiting like any other business, no matter how big or small you may be. And try to turn the trend to a positive trend where people are coming here because of economic opportunities. To me, that's the crucial and main issue that we should be dealing with now, right? Not providing more free stuff.
We will pick up on this the next time you come in. Thanks, Senator.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information on what we discussed today, DeFrancisco.mysenate.gov.